بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رب اشرح صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A blessed praise. We ask him to send his peace and blessings upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, upon his companions, his family and those who follow them until the end of time. Assalamu alaikum everybody. Alhamdulillah, we're going to do a few reflections on the Isra and Mi'raj, which took place according to the majority of our scholars in the 10th year after the beginning of prophecy of the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, before we do that, let's just talk about some methodologies for teaching the seerah. And if you are a teacher, Islamic studies teacher, or you're a youth director, or you're involved in an MSA, you should really think about the manahij, how you teach and how you instruct people. Because what happens is, I've been there, I was in the same position as a convert, as well as in charge of an MSA at one time. You know, you find yourself kind of in a very big ocean. Even as someone who was dealing with religious programming in a larger institution at one time, I found the resources are abundant, but then it's important to understand the philosophy behind why resources exist, if you will. What is the educational philosophy of the resource that you're using so that you ensure you use it in the best way? And this is extremely important when we're talking about tafsir. We should know why a scholar has written an explanation of Quran. I mean, think about it. Why isn't there just one explanation? You know, it's like, can't someone just write one explanation and it's enough for us? So then obviously people over time felt certain reasons or motivations for writing tafsir. The same thing can be said for the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that now, especially in English, we're finding a large number of books dedicated to the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whereas over generations and generations and generations, there's always been someone who felt a need to write something about his life. So when we're talking about seerah, we're really talking about potentially 3 to 4 ideologies that have spawned, if you will, the writing or collection of the seerah. The first was to discover what actually authentically happened. And we call this tahqiq. So whoever wrote it, their goal was to really make sure that this actually happened in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there's 2 points you should know about this, and it's extremely important, that for every group of scholars in Islam, there were different criterion for accepting what was authentic on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the modern era, especially in the West, the fetish for the science of hadith has created a tremendous problem, and that is that the scholars of hadith, they understood that the goal of hadith primarily was rulings. And that's why Al-Bukhari, when you read it, you may get lost, because Imam Bukhari is a lawyer. He's actually a Supreme Court judge. So he's collecting a book of legal issues, right? That's why the fuqaha say it's the Taj of the books of hadith, right? It's the greatest book of hadith. So his goal is to show you this is Sahih al-Jami', what has been brought together, which is authentically related on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we know that Al-Bukhari, he differed with all of the other scholars of hadith in his criterion. He was extremely stringent, radiyallahu anhu. But the point is that methodology had spilled over into seerah. So now you'll find people discussing, you know, did those doves actually, you know, sit in front of the cave? Was there actually a web and some spiders? Whereas if you read, the scholars of history considered that authentic. They considered that narration authentic. But our community has become, and this is also an outcome of speed and haste, the need for modernity to push us to be right all the time. We've actually gone beyond what Islam has asked us, and we've become, you know, really, really enamored with the idea of everything being 100% authentic. Whereas the scholars of history, when it came to collecting narrations on behalf of the Prophet ﷺ, were much more relaxed. Because they understood if they were as stringent as the scholars of hadith, you'll have no history. You'll have no history. So that's why historians, you'll find in their books, like, why are they narrating Isra'iliyat? Why are they narrating, you know, narrations of other religious communities? Because they are much more mutasahil in their acceptance of narrations. And I find it problematic that we introduce a fledgling community in the West to the idea that there may be fraudulent reports in their very initial engagements with the life of the Prophet in his seerah. Because what that does is it causes us to doubt our scholars, and we become postmodernist. We deconstruct everything, so the only thing left is Abu Mus'ab. The only thing left is absolute chaos. The only thing left is Asr al-Nu'mani. The only thing left is absolute chaos, instead of some kind of symmetry where we can have marji'iyat references. So the first really philosophy behind writing the seerah was to affirm whether something happened. The scholars of tariq, mu'arrikhin, they were much more relaxed than the scholars of hadith. The idea, and this is important to note, of interjecting the science of hadith into the science of seerah started less than 50 years ago. Doesn't mean that it's bad, but it means that it's something good. And inshallah, those people who did that, Sheikh Nasr al-Din Albani, other great scholars, inshallah, they will be rewarded for their intentions, inshallah, which I'm sure were the best. The second reason that people wrote history was to collect everything that was related on behalf of the Prophet ﷺ, anything that happened in his life. Al-Waqidi is a great scholar, he did this. Whether it was authentic, whether it was an absolute fabrication, whether it was true, they collected it. Indeed, and that's why you find in the classical books of history sometimes 22 volumes. Compare that to the seerah that you're going to buy in the bookstore here, it's only one volume. So you're obviously only getting like, you know, the top 40. You're not getting the underground remix, right? Or the underground remix is 22 volumes, right? We call it a jama'. The philosophy of that writer was to collect. And who uses this usually are the Orientalists. So they will go and find some really spurious narrations and present those, for example, in academia, as though these are the absolute truth on truth. So now you see why it's important to know the philosophy. One of the writers of seerah like this was Imam al-Tabari. Well, Tabarani, excuse me, and his history of the Prophet ﷺ, Imam Ibn Kathir, and his seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam. The third is that we're seeing now in recent history the idea of an author sharing with you his or her personal reflections with the seerah, right? So mudhakkaratu, how he or she felt in reading the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we find that in Amr Khalid, really he started this, Ala Khutwat al-Habibi, had this TV show, you know, upon the footsteps of the beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then in English we have, of course, the excellent book of Dr. Tariq Ramadan, you know, also on the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are his personal reflections. The fourth, and I believe this is the most important for you, and I could be wrong unless I'm right. As Imam Shaf used to say, I'm right as long as I'm not wrong. And that is, where is the collective reflection of the community in the seerah? When we study the seerah, are we able to take, and this is what usually happens as a philosophy, when we study the life of the Prophet ﷺ, we are thinking that we have to project, right, the McCormick Center back into Mecca, this conference back into Medina. Whereas I want to challenge you, when I'm talking about collective community reflections, to take Medina and Mecca and reflect it back into your world, back into Cleveland, back into DC, back into Chicago, back into LA. Let me give you some examples of how this would work, because if we're able to do this as a community, what Benjamin Bloom, he wrote about in his taxonomy of learning, the idea of synthesis. We call it in Usul al-Fiqh al-Jam'. The Malikis, we said it's an obligation. Wal-Jam'u wajibun ma'amkana. In one poem we had to memorize, don't worry about it. I like poetry, sorry. All kinds. Wal-Jam'u wajibun ma'amkana means if you can marry two things together, it's better. If you can make things work together, we talked about it the other day in the morning, nuancing and building instead of destroying. So for example, let's say we're in a mosque, we're tonight having a discussion about what it means to be a minority in America as a blonde-haired, blue-eyed white male. I have no idea how I'm supposed to speak to that topic, because I'm the victim of appropriation, right, and privilege. That doesn't mean I should deny my whiteness, that means I should use it for Allah. But if we're in a community and we're trying to understand, you know, all these non-Muslims, it's Christmas, you know, these kufar, ya'buduna salib, they worship a cross, musharif eh. Okay.
We have some Egyptians here? Sorry. What? I was in Toronto, so I'm still speaking Arabic. You know, Toronto's like a whole different world. So what I said is, you know, they worship the cross, they do this. So what does every book of Sirah start with? And as a community, we should have a discussion. There should be some reading, and then there should be a discussion. And that discussion should lead to institutional policy, where now the Sirah is guiding the decisions of our community at a meta level, not a micro level. What is always the first chapter in the Sirah? His birth? No, it comes later. Before his birth, you got to know about who? Before the Arabs, you got to know about who? Nasabu. Right? His lineage. So immediately we're taught that we should respect the asaba. You know, asaba is a hard word to translate in Arabic. It's more like, you know, your central nervous system, your people. So when I go to Oklahoma, even though as soon as I could run, I ran from Oklahoma. There's a certain way we talk, that, we say that. We don't say that. It's like the Sa'idis in Egypt, Bilwagi. We have our own lahja in Oklahoma. Cuz, because. If you go to Oklahoma and say, because I want to, they're like, you're not from here. Like if you go to Egypt and you're like, لَقَدْ جِئْتُ مِنْ مَكَانْ بَعِيدٍ لِكَ أَشْتَرِيَ هَذِهِ سِرْعَ. Like if you talk like that in Egypt, they're like, دَامِشْ مِنْ هُنَ. He ain't from here. Same thing in Oklahoma, right? So we learn of the lineage of the prophet, and we see that that lineage plays throughout his seerah. And that is going to lead up to an important point about in Isra wa Mi'raj, the use of social capital before miracles. The employment of social capital before a miracle happens. Every instance to utilize relationships between people, al-asaba, is exploited before Isra Mi'raj happens. We as a community are waiting for a miracle to happen instead of trying to build relationships with these people. So we've inverted the seerah. Now you see what I mean by policy? So we're waiting for manna and salwa to come from the heavens. We're waiting for Imam Mahdi to come back. Whereas if we were following the seerah, you know what we would have done yesterday in Chicago? Every single one of us would have given an extra $8 to feed one homeless person on Christmas Day in this city. You would have fed, in the name of Islam, more than 2,000 people in this city in one day. You don't think that will create social capital? And if you think it's haram, don't check the box and step in the name of your Lord. Because I ain't got time to argue with you. But I'm going to tell you this. If we don't start winning the hearts of these people through real relations, it's starting to get ugly. Just ask the hijabis. And that's very important. So we learn the nasab to value relationships with people. We convert to Islam, we forget our family, we forget our friends. Man, bump them kafirs, dog. It's about to huck. And then when you get 40, you have no social capital in the Muslim community, and you have no social capital in the kafir community, and you find yourself lonely. Look in Medina. After the conquering of Mecca, the Prophet says something we believe every word he said when it comes to religious issues is a mu'jiza, is a miracle. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. He doesn't speak from his desires. What does he say to his wife when they go back to Mecca after they conquered the city? Instead of having that bravado, he says, إِنْ لَمْ يُحْدِثُ قَوْمُكَ. If it wasn't that your people, he keeps that relation. Even after victory, he recognizes, look, you gotta be Amin before you can be Nabi. In America, we wanna be Nabi before we've been Amin. So what do we learn from the seerah here? Why would all the scholars take the time to talk about his uncles, his aunties, his cousins, his third niece on the fifth side who had this cousin named, you know, Qara'a, who got killed by a stone when he was walking by Thamud? You know all about his family. You're like, who is that? I can't. And if you're Arab, you're like, ka. How the, it's some sa'ab jiddin. It's still sha'ab. What the heck kind of name is this? Mostosha'ab. Yani he grows like grass? Sa'ab. Right? But all of his family is greatly detailed to show you, you better invest in having relationships that go beyond just theology and their social capital. What's the second chapter in the life of the Prophet ﷺ. After that is what? Creates policy. Very important. Is the Arabs. Who were the Arabs? Are we talking about like Tabaqat al-Awliya? Is this like a book of the Salihin, or is this a book of the Mufsidin? And it gives you stories of how they got married. Good Lord, they were crazy. How they used to fight over camels, their faith. You know, Zuhair, he says, وَلَكِنَّنِي أَنْ أَمْسِلْ أَنْ الْغَدْ الْأَعْمَى. You know, in the Mu'alaqat to Sab'i, he said, you know, about what's going to happen tomorrow, I'm blind. I don't believe in anything. Desperate life. Imr al-Qais, man, he talks about girls, you know, the way that Chris Brown talks about girls. Seriously. Like his ideas, objectification of females is very similar to what you see now, right? It's just laced in metaphor. But still, not only is that chapter about the Arabs, it's about the what? What about the Arabs? Y'all are like, he's making us think. Can you tell a joke? I got a joke for tonight, it's a good one. It involves DJ Khaled. I did it last night at work, so. I don't know, Tim Hortons versus Starbucks, we'll see what happens. But really, it's the good qualities of the Arabs. Like what made them good for Islam? And Allah says about them, fi dhalalin mubin, you were submerged in misguidance. You people were lost. When Umar became Muslim, Allah said, أَوَ مَنْ كَنَ مَيْتًا فَأَحْيَيْنَاهُ. He was dead and we brought him to life. So what are we taught now in America? That Fetty Wap has good qualities. Yeah, you got to find good qualities in Fetty. Because the Prophet had to find good qualities in the Arabs around him. Even though they were wild and crazy. They gambled, they got drunk. They got fleet with it. They had a trap house, but it was with camels. There was no difference. But you still had to find good in Justin Bieber, that hubris and that narcissism. You got to find good in those kind of people. So then I ask people when I teach them seerah, what are the good qualities of Americans for Islam? And I have, every time, someone will raise their hand and say, are we allowed to think that way? No, seriously, because there's a pathos in our mind that's rooted in insecurities coupled with convert angst and immigrant angst that's rooted in fear. So everything around us is like, potential, I'm gonna lose my deen. Mom, can I go to the mall? Oh Allah, I'm gonna pray two rakat. This girl going to the mall. Oh God, don't go to Claire's. Please don't go to Claire's. Forever 21, ya Allah, Rabbana. Right? Fear, I mean, you go Forever 21 and you lose your deen, you had no deen in the first place. Or any fashion sense. But the point, no, seriously, you know what I'm saying? The point is, we're ordered, every book of seerah takes the time, brothers, to tell us how to find good qualities in bad people. That's a policy. So when one of those buck crazy lunatic nihilistic white boys comes to the mosque, it's like, can I use the restroom, man? We're like, nah, astaghfirullah, nah, you can't come in here, dog. I mean, not dog, cat. No, we're like, go ahead. I met Imam Shibli, Hamid Shibli from Jersey, man. He's a sweetheart, man. You know, Allah help him, he's in Jersey, but still, he's a good brother. And he told me that he went out in this parking lot last week and there was this non-Muslim dude knocked out in his car. So he knocked on his car. The guy was like, I'm gonna leave. And he said, no, you can sleep in my office. Yeah, that's dawah. That's like that Kendrick Lamar dawah. Like you got Drake and you got Kendrick. That's like that other level where they say the same thing, but he says it in like 100 different metaphors. Seriously. I mean, that's like you telling, imagine that guy when he goes home and his family is watching Fox News and he's like, I slept in the office of the imam. He slept in his office. Like that's dawah, little crazy, but dawah. I'm not gonna let no one in my office. But the point is, he sees good in people. So I ask Muslims, now you should write this down. Give me 5 good qualities for these people to become Muslim. What are the good things they could bring to Islam? So we learn that it's a policy to see good. The Prophet said, Anasul Ma'adin in Bukhari, people like metals. In order to get the metal, don't you have to get dirty? In order to get the metal, don't you have to dig deep? You can't be so self-righteous that you just walk on top of the earth and condemn everything under the ground. But that's what we do. When I read fatwas from overseas, I had a sheikh once. He wrote a fatwa about Christmas. I went to visit him to his house. I said, "Sheikh, have you ever had a non-Muslim friend?" "No." "You have a non-Muslim relative?" "No." "Then how you gonna talk about non-Muslims?" When you know that the first thing in a fatwa is at-tasawwur al-haqiqa, to understand the situation that you're in, to be able to see with basira whether halal or haram. So what I'm doing now before we get to Isra wa Mi'raj is I just want to show you reflective seerah. Community should be led by a scholar. I think the best seerah out there right now is the seerah of Dr. Yasir Qadhi on YouTube. It's absolutely incredible. But that's only the beginning. That's not the ending. Because that should lead to institutional policy. So for example, the first one, institutional policy, to be invested in community organization, to be invested in social justice issues. I went to Tamir Rice's grave, man. Black people came out of the houses and said, "Who's this big old white dude?" And Imam Bashir, he said, "This is an imam." They said, "God bless the Muslims." He said, "God bless them. They're going through it. All this Islamophobia, and this big white boy is here in our neighborhood filming at the graves, at the murder site of Tamir Rice." That's that intersection between universal values and community organization, right? I love how Linda Sarsour responded when she said, "If my hijab is not part of your feminism, take your feminism and run with it." That's how you coalition build. You create affinity between each other. Lita arafu. The second thing we said is what? To see good in people. You know how I became Muslim? I became Muslim through a dua of a black Muslim brother who became Muslim in 1962 in Brooklyn, New York. My first teacher, Sheikh Abdurrahman Basir, who's now almost 80. It was wild, man. I was in the market high as a kite. This is before Islam. And he saw me. And then 3 years later when I took Shahada, I took Shahada with him. He started crying. He said, "Man, I ask Allah to guide you the first time I saw you. I said something good about this kid, even though he's crazy. There is something good in there." So we should see the good in people. Allahumma izzal Islam bi Umarain. Oh Allah, strengthen Islam with Umarain, with one of the two Umars. We're talking about an Umar who a woman said his himar aslama abla. You know, his donkey will become Muslim before him. The Prophet sees good in him. He sees khair in him. Hind, the wife of Abu Sufyan, she's evil, man. But the Prophet sees good in her. He doesn't allow i'dilu huwa aqrabu li taqwa. He doesn't allow his personal, emotional situation to swerve him from seeing justice. So that takes us to Isra al-Mi'raj. And I remember what we're talking about are ways that the seerah has been written. And I believe the fourth, it hasn't really been focused on in a long time. In Egypt, in Azhar, you know, we had a halaqa of seerah, a study circle of seerah that has not stopped for 900 years. One of my teachers say, "Fiha hayati," in it is my life. Abu Hassan al-Nadwi, radiallahu anhu, from India, great scholar, was the foremost scholar of Arabic, and he's from India. He died in the late 90s. You know, he talks about in his memoirs how he went to buy a copy of Sirah and it was sold out when he was 9 years old, and he wept. You know, he cried. Maybe like how we felt when we couldn't get into Star Wars, you know? No, I'm saying like that same kind of like, you know, same excitement, right? He had that for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that's the next point. If you're gonna study the seerah, you have to be passionate. If there's no passion, you're just wasting your time. What makes people on falsehood successful, the Islamophobes, is passion. They're passionate for evil. We should be passionate for good. Now, when we talk about Isra wa Mi'raj, I alluded to it earlier, but I want to make this point again. If we're going to study it in the light of reflective seerah, and then we'll stop, inshallah, take some questions, and then we'll be out. That is that according to most scholars, Al-Qadi Abu Bakr ibn Al-Arabi, the Maliki Faqih, he said that according to most people, it happened the 10th year. Ibn Abd al-Barr is a great scholar. He said some said the 11th, some said the 13th. Most said the 10th or 11th. There's a point here. Why would this incredible miracle take so long? The only great miracle that happened prior to that that's mutawatir, that has reached us through infinite number of chains is the Quran and prophethood. Everything else, you know, scholars a little bit debatable, this, and then bam, Isra wa Mi'raj. So these are like definitive events. Everybody agrees about it. What do you think was happening in that first 10 years? And how should that play out for us as a community? And I made this point, you as an MSA. See, in the 90s, and I'll be honest with you, because we took our fiqh from overseas, and I understand our scholars from overseas, I live with them for almost 10 years. And I understand the ethos that drives them is an ethos of mercy. They are worried about Muslims in the West. You know, they think that it's like heathenism with impunity over here, like absolute debauchery, right? So the fatwa that come out of those centers usually are fatwas which seek to be protective, what we call in fatwa ihtiyatan, like to go beyond what's normal to ensure safety of people, right? But as you and I know, sometimes in America, the best thing to do is take the bull by the horns. And sometimes it's to back off. Sometimes it's to be hard. Sometimes it's to back off. Sometimes it's to stake a claim. Sometimes to pull out. Sometimes to be strategic. And you wouldn't be able to do that because you live here, you can nuance it. So the first 10 years, what is happening in Mecca is the exploitation of religious and social capital. And I would say social capital more than religious capital. What I mean by that is, how much power do you have religiously? The Muslims in Mecca had very little power religiously. They were not able to worship Allah freely. They were the objects of Islamophobia. The first objects of Islamophobia are in Mecca. It wasn't popular. When the Prophet migrates to Medina, there are only 67 Muslims. Don't have this like romantic notions like the whole desert was full of people and it was all bouncing, they were Ubering it to Medina. Nah, it wasn't like that. It was 67 people. But who becomes Muslim in the beginning? And this is what I mean by social capital. Is perhaps the most influential person in the city is who? Is Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr is on the Forbes top 10 list. Abu Bakr financially is considered a don. Abu Bakr is one of the few people who can read and write. There were only 10 people in Mecca who can read and write. So Abu Bakr brings an educational capital, a business acumen, and he brings character. Why would the most important person, after Abu Jahl, some say, is Abu Bakr in his talent? Because Abu Bakr is not only bringing religious capital, but he's bringing social capital. And that's why the first day he becomes Muslim, what happens? What does he do? As soon as he accepts Islam, who does he run to? Uthman ibn Affan, Abdurrahman ibn Auf. He goes to other ballers because that's his clique. That's his crew. That's his boys. Do you think Abu Bakr, that first day he became Muslim, was like, فَأَمَّ تَوْحِيدُ فَقَدْ إِنْقَسَمَ إِلَى ثَلَاثَةِ أَقْسَامٍ فَالْأَوَّلِ Like, do you think he knew theology? You think he was able, like, if they ask him, what does the hand of Allah mean? Well, according to Razi, it means this, and Ibn Taymiyyah, it means this, and Ghazali, it means this. Or do you think he used his social capital and his character to sway them into faith? Which one do you think? It was his social capital. And then Uthman, he goes and gets busy and brings three more. Social capital. And the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he comes back to his wife and he says, Zammiluni, cover me, she doesn't say to him, Anta a'lam al-ulama ala wajhi al-ardi faqad istafaka rabbuk. She's telling him, like, you're the greatest prophet. She doesn't know that. She says, you tell the truth, you're good to people. Social capital. So the first 10 years is really the exercise and exploiting good relationships with society before Isra al-Mi'raj happens. Why is that important? How important do you think the convert community is in doing that? And where are they in our community? I'm a lone wolf, I'm a lone Jedi. Where are they? You go to Dawah programs, it's always like non-converts. Like, hi, I'm in charge of the da'wah. I just came from Egypt like last year. What? No disrespect to you, bro. I love Egyptians. I can make you ta'amiyya and food, and I can even do ragif in my house. But don't you think this person has more social capital than you in knowing how to talk to these people? And I say that respectively. Or you find someone from Pakistan or India who just came to America and doesn't understand the difference that Usher doesn't work in a theater and 50 cents ain't change. And I don't mean to talk down to people. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying the seerah, the first 10 years, is really brought about a great success because people use their social capital. They were not theologians. There was no ahkam. There was tawheed and character and relations. And when that fails, when that no longer can happen, look at the Prophet, how he tries to be so industrious and utilizing social capital that he goes to Taif because he knows, you know what, I got some distant relatives, aqarib hunak. So maybe if I go to Taif, those relationships will matter. And when that didn't matter, you have Isra Mi'raj. As if to tell us as a community, you have to utilize all of your social capital and then look for the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're waiting on a miracle. But how many of us, I love it when I meet Muslim brothers and sisters, like they invite their neighbors over, they have a relationship with their friends, they build social capital in their communities. And not only the converts, these young Muslims who have the language of the balad, the dhoq of the balad, and we say dhoq, the taste of the country. They understand how to deal with people. Like that young sister in California, man, yearbook picture of the year. It was on BuzzFeed. Sister with hijab, what did it say? I only wear this to give you women a chance. I mean, look at how y'all laugh, right? Because you understand, that's that dhoq, you feel it. One gentleman came to me, he was from a different place, he just got her, he's like, this is not good, how could she say this? I said, man, just stay in your lane, bro, trust me. That's fire right there. Fire, no, not that fire, man, the metaphor. It's a metaphor for good. So that's why I want to encourage you. I'm going to talk about this tonight again. You should be involved as passionately as you are for Palestine, as passionately as you are for Kashmir in America. And until that happens, we will continue to have problems in this country. And I'm not saying neglect those. See, we run to two extremes, but I'm saying, don't you think the house you live in should be first and foremost for you? Because if you ain't got a house, you can't welcome no guests. And then you exploit that social capital and you build relationships with people and then you become Amin. After all that fails, Isra Mi'raj happens. After severe rejection, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi. The one who made Isra with his slave, his servant Muhammad. We learn something there that, as Al-Qurtubi said, the closest anyone has ever been to Allah is Isra al-Mi'raj, and Allah didn't say, Subhanalladhi, who made Isra with his Rasul or his Prophet. He said, with his servant. So Qurtubi said, the way to draw nearer to Allah is through servitude. So social capital and worship. These are the two major anchors of the early seerah and consistency. And we learn something else, that as a community, we should be concerned about the emotional states of people, not just the physical. We are a community who has adopted simply the language of fiqh. Everything has a ruling, but Islam has multiple languages. The language of beauty, the language of emotions. Mu'adh used to say, every time I met the Prophet, he would say, Wallahi ya Mu'adh inni uhibbuk, Mu'adh, I love you. To the extent that the last meeting of the Prophet was Sayyidina Mu'adh, Mu'adh, he weeps because of this incredible relationship with him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But what I mean by as a community, if we're reflecting on Isra al-Mi'raj, we should think about the emotional needs of the people. Bear with me. Two things happen in that year. One is Surat al-Kahf is revealed. A few things. Surat Yusuf is revealed. Surat Yasin is revealed. Surat al-A'raf is revealed. And Surat al-Jin is revealed. I did that on purpose. You know why? To show you social capital. See, I got the Egyptians involved now. social capital. Wallahi, I did it on purpose. Now I'm in trouble. I have to like, a'ulak, I have to do all the Arabic accents, so I'll be in trouble. Sakhla b'khair, saktayab, shlonek. And then, oh. I'm not going to do that though, because I got to keep it from my folks. But the point is, Surat al-Jin comes and Isra al-Mi'raj comes because it's looking after the emotional health of the community. Absolute rejection has happened. The Prophet has lost his wife. He's lost his grandfather in the 8th year. Then he loses his uncle in the 10th. And then he's, of course, that's why some call it the year of sadness. There's two reasons why they say that is. One is, of course, he lost his family. And then there's this embargo on his community. If there was an Arabic Twitter, you wouldn't find this in the top 10 under, you know, Steve Harvey. It's not going to be there. It wasn't a cool thing to be Muslim. But there's this sense of rejection. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas says, we were so dejected that we considered living off the urine of camels because we had nothing to drink. Ibn Hisham says that some of the Sahaba lived off grass in that time period. There's this strong sense of rejection. Nobody's talking to you. No one does business with you, even though it's profitable. And you talk about social capital. Who becomes Muslim in the early days? Abu Bakr, the height of the height. Bilal, who's a slave. So you have Pharaoh and you have the Hebrews with Muhammad. Then you have a woman, Khadija. Then you have Sayyidina Ali, a youth. So every social demographic in the early part of the seerah has become Muslim to maximize social presence and social capital. So as a community, we're still debating about the participation of women, and we have a woman like Khadija in our history. We're debating the participation of young people. Look at the young youth groups in the evangelical community. They have rock concerts with 25,000 youth in San Francisco. And it's the worst rock music I've ever heard in my life. I don't know how they pull it off, but they do. But we're debating, should youth be involved? That's social capital. 45% of our community is under 36. They're saying now the millennials are going to be the population explosion that make the baby boomers look like the babies went extinct. And we don't want to employ young people in our community for social capital. When Obama won in 2008, they say he won on the youth. In 92, when I was 17, they say Clinton won on the youth. And we're debating the participation of you in our community when Islam starts with Sayyidina Ali, one of the greatest youth, women, Khadija. We're looking at those who are less fortunate in our community, the underserved. I don't like these words, less fortunate and poor, the underserved. And we're debating a role they have in our community and the wealthy. So every social demographic is there, surrounding, orbiting the religious piece is the Prophet. You see that? That's social capital at every possible demographic you can imagine. And then rejection. And here's the emotional support piece. Oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wow. Oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh community of the Prophet who is weak and fledgling. If the entire world has rejected you, we in the heavens have accepted you. That's the lesson of Isra al-Mi'raj. And now we're faced with that challenge in the face of Islamophobia. Might not be cool to be Muslim anymore. In the 90s, it was cool to be Muslim. Lauryn Hill, right, talking about Shaitan and the Jinn with the Fugees. It was cool to be Muslim. Siraj Wahaj is on a Tribe Called Quest album in 1994. You listen to it, you're like, yo, Tip is here. Is that Imam Siraj? Am I supposed to be listening to music? Right? Well, he's on it, okay. But if everyone around you rejects you, and you're doing what causes everyone in the heavens to accept you, then you should take an emotional break and understand that you are valued by the unseen. So that's why Surat al-Jin is sent. If human beings ain't got your back, قُلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ, the jinn got your back. إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا يَهْدِي إِلَى رُشْدِ فَآمَنَا بِهِ. Thirdly, all of the malaika are with you. And fourthly, all of the prophets are with you. So don't worry about these people, man. If they reject you on this whack earth, the one in the dope heavens has accepted you, O Muhammad and his companions. The last lesson, we don't have time, man. I didn't know this is short. My bad, bro. I mean, this is the seerah. The seerah, it requires investment. Because seer means to siru, to follow. Is as an ummah, you should be happy. You should always be confident. You should be passionate. You know, I became Muslim at a time when it was cool to become a Muslim. You know, I was a member of the Bloods. I went back to my high school and they were like, yo, let's smoke this. I was like, I can't do that. And they're like, let's go get this hot link and some strawberry pop, if you know what that is. Wow. I said, I can't do that. I said, man, what happened? Blood? I was like, I can't do that either. Blood? And they're like, why? And I was like, I became Muslim. They're like, that's all good. You good. Wallahi. They're like, they didn't know alhamdulillah. They could have said alhamdulillah. And four of my friends became Muslim from that gang in high school. We played basketball for Blake Griffin's father, Tommy Griffin. But the point is, there was a time where, like, if you did that, and getting back to social capital, there is no demographic in this country that is more important to us at a social demographic level than Black America. You walk through any inner city with hijab on or a kufi on, I swear to God, somebody will give you salam. And then you ask him, yo, you Muslim? Nah, man, my cousin is. In DC, I finished the khutbah, I was walking on with a kufi on, a crack fiend rose up, and don't laugh at her, because this is a musibah that we ask Allah to protect us from. And she's a beautiful woman. She lives in the projects across the street from my house until they shut it down in the name of gentrification, the most gracious, the most merciful. And as I was walking home, I had one of those Moroccan kufis. You know the Moroccans, mashallah, they're the Esquire of the Muslim world, you know what I'm saying? Their clothes are like, what? It's like Lebanese food, Moroccan got the clothes. So I'm going, and she pulls up on her bike. This woman probably weighs 100 pounds. And she says to me, yo, what's up? I said, what's up? What's cracking? She's like, oh, okay. Okay, now I want real white dudes. Okay, hey. She said, salaikum salam. I said, what? I said, why salaikum salam? I don't know what that means in Arabic. I'm trying, you know what I'm saying? And then she said to me, yo, I got a question. I said, go ahead, shoot. Shoot means ask. Don't get scared. And then she said to me, some people in suburbs like, I didn't hear that on Mob Beep's record. Right? And then she said to me, yo, where can I get that red kufi? And I started crying. I went home and wept because we neglected this woman. She knows what a kufi is, man. And she said, I knew you was Muslim because you got that beard and you wearing that kufi. And my uncle is Muslim. So, like, we're neglecting Black America when Black America is the most important demographic that will fight with you when the ish hits the fan. And I'm going to be honest with you. And that's why when Islamophobia started, you saw two groups. I got more phone calls from these two groups than anyone else. The Jews and the Black church. And the Black church said, y'all raised $100,000 for our churches down there in the South. Man, we ain't forgetting that. And Muslims were actually arguing about this on Twitter, like, should we raise money for Black churches? Like, just be quiet. Go. We think we're so special, we can argue in the street. My mother and father would fight, and they would say, baby, shut the door. You wouldn't see nothing, though. They come out, baby, let's go out to eat. Chipotle or Taco Bell? Chipotle, extra meat, babe. But I'm saying is they had enough guts to know not to fight in front of their kids. We online study Quran. Oh, let's all fight about it in front of America. Brilliant strategy. Because why? We so special. Okay, let's fight about, you know, should we have helped those Black churches or not? You don't think Black America watched that debate and said, man, this is a divided community that we can't trust. So the last piece is that Isra al-Mi'raj teaches us, and I have to finish before my man loses it, but Isra teaches us patience. It teaches us that there's a great honor in being a Muslim. Something you gotta live up to. Should be proud of. You know how? Imam al-Suyuti says, who's a Sahabi? He said a Sahabi is someone who sees the Prophet, believes in the Prophet, and dies a Muslim. If I ask you who's the greatest companion, you'll tell me Abu Bakr. Al-Suyuti said, nope. The greatest companion is Isa. He wrote this in a book called Khasa'is al-Kubra, which means why it's special to be a Muslim. Not you should be proud, but you should be humbled. You should feel the grace of God in being a Muslim in your life, man. Not bravado and arrogance and cockiness, but like humility. And he said, because Isa is the only prophet who's not dead yet. And on the night of Isra al-Mi'raj, Ra'a Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa salla wara. He saw the prophet. He believed in him, he prayed behind him, which is the side of Iman. Thus, the greatest Sahabi is a prophet in your community. So then he said, Ma ajmal al ummah hadhi. He said, is there any more beautiful ummah than this? That prophets are part of this ummah. So the last lesson, we don't have time to go through the rest of Isra al-Mi'raj, is you're a baller if you're a Muslim. You're a ball of freaking awesome. And you should never feel down and low. Because Isra tells the Prophet, you're at the lowest of the low, but in the heavens you're in Maqam and Mahmud. May Allah bless all of you and strengthen you, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum.
MashaAllah, beautiful words from a beautiful man.
Thanks, bro.
For the record, if it was up to me, I'd let you stay here till Fajr and talk. But inshallah, we're going to get some Q&A, that way we can learn from you, inshallah. We'll start with something I think is really important for all of us. What books do you recommend in Arabic or English for the seerah?
That's a great question. I love it when people ask about resources. That means that this lecture is going to go beyond the lecture, right? This is the beginning. This is not the end. Don't say to yourself, like on Twitter, oh my gosh, I was at this lecture. It was the most amazing lecture I ever heard. Although you can. And follow me. But the point, if you follow Usher, you can follow me. So point is this. This is the beginning. Every talk you hear right now is a beginning. It's a launching point. Remember we talked about 2 days ago, right? The Mabadi launching points. This is not the end. This is where you started. So the best book I've ever seen in my life in the English language, and God knows best, of course, is one that recently came out called Revelation by Dr. Mihraj Mohideen. I'll put it on my Twitter, so that way you have to follow me, and a picture. It just came out. It's $79. I understand. I was in college, and I used to put stuff on layaway, even like hamburgers and stuff, because it's college. You have no money. But it is the first book I've ever seen written in the seerah, which is like a textbook, but not boring. It has a glossary of all the names. It has maps of all the events, like color, like the gloss. It looks like someone put like clear foundation on every page. I know what that is. It's absolutely amazing, right? So it's called Revelation by Dr. Mi'raj Mohideen. Just came out. The book in Arabic, I would say the books of Dr. Muhammad Salabi. They're two volumes called Sirah al-Nabawiyah. It's very nice, mashallah. Very nice.
Jazakallah khair. Next question. What actions can we start to implement in our daily life to ensure social justice?
I think you have to be part of the social justice movement, right? You have to get involved. And, you know, yesterday in Toronto, someone asked me, can you give us a question on activism? I said, let's go do some activities. Like, again, I said it, those of you who are late, why don't every Christmas day, those of you who don't have a problem with it and you follow the fatwa that allows it, which is the fatwa of some Malikis and some Hanabila, and that is that why don't we all donate an extra $8 to buy a plate of food for all the homeless people in downtown Chicago and serve Christmas dinner every Christmas when you have this event? You would be feeding 2,000 people. You don't think the press will cover that? You don't think you could invite the mayor? You don't think that's social capital? You don't think you'll learn about community organization? If you live in Chicago, if I lived in Chicago, I would make a fatwa that you have to spend time with Iman, Rami Nashashibi, and those people. If you live in Chicago, you're out in the burbs, that's great. The burbs, don't feel bad living in the burbs. The burbs is a blessed place, man. But Iman, Inner City Muslim Action Network in Chicago, I have never seen anyone doing prophetic work in the way that they do prophetic work. You're talking about an institution where prisoners come out of prison, they build homes, re-entry homes for those prisoners that are green certified. These prisoners learn how to be construction workers by building their own homes. They're licensed as apprentices. They become full-fledged construction workers, and then one of the brothers moves into the home. That's not meaningful work. That's not powerful work. Secondly, I know Sheikh Jamal and Sheikh Kifah in the area, you know, go volunteer in these large institutions. The Palestinian brothers and sisters, man, they got a knack for that community work, man. They got a knack for social justice. And you know why? Because they, as a people, are collectively under so much stress and so much pressure. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help people of Palestine, man. Mm-hmm. Largest open-air prison in the world. And we have Muslims that will do MLI? Like, really, though? You know, where we should all be in BDS, right? So I would encourage you, those are two local volunteers. If you live outside of Chicago, take a class on community organization anywhere. Search it online. Something's going to come up. There's a book called Rules for Radicals. Saul Alinsky talks about how to organize around campaigns in your community, how to create volunteer coordinators, how to operate properly as an institution and an organization.
Okay, I think it's a really, really heavy question, so take your time with the answer.
Those weren't heavy?
Yeah. How do you instill unconditional love for the Prophet in your heart?
None of us could ever have unconditional love for the Prophet. You know why? We're not prophets. to have perfect iman and a perfect love for, we don't have perfect love for our kids, man. Oh, your baby's so cute. Oh, I love my baby. What's that smell? Can you hold my baby, please? What happened to unconditional love? Well, you know, conditions have conditions. So to ask ourselves to have unconditional love for the Prophet would be to ask us to do something that Allah has not asked us to do. What we have to do is strive to love him. And the best way to love him is to study his life. And then this exercise, I just walked you through a teaching method, right? How we talk about his life, and then, but ideally it would be a discussion with you, right? It's a discussion. Because you have incredible reflections in your life where you're like, man, this is like the seerah, man. That man, this is like the seerah. That's how you develop that love for the Prophet. For example, the gang crisis, the vice lords and the folk in Chicago. What's the difference between that and the Aus and the Khazraj in Medina? That's how we should study the seerah. Right. Not just like, okay, so this is Medina and that happened. Okay, ma salama.
Okay, I think that's all our time, but I'll ask one last question before we go. What is your Snapchat name so we can follow you?
Everybody got your phone, I'm not gonna tell you. No, I'm just joking. Imam Sohaib Webb, like really hard name, follow. Imam Sohaib Webb, yeah, mashallah. I might be meeting DJ Khaled next week, so.
Inshallah.
That's gonna be one heck of a key to success.
Inshallah, Jazakallah Khair. If everyone can give a round of applause. May Allah reward you all.